HENSOLDT Analytics presents the Intelligence Brief Podcast, OSINT and its application. In this episode, BBC monitoring disinformation expert Shayan Sardarizadeh and OSINT analyst Lynn Dudenhöfer discuss disinformation campaigns surrounding COVID-19 and the vaccination mandates. Stay tuned to find out more about fake news, the most common platforms used to spread disinformation, and the potential future targets of conspiracy theorists once the topic of COVID-19 becomes obsolete.
Welcome to the Intelligence Brief Podcast, OSINT and its application. My name is Lynn Dudenhöfer, and today I have with me Shayan Sardarizadeh, who's a disinformation journalist with BBC Monitoring. BBC Monitoring is a department within the BBC, which specializes in open source media monitoring in the themes of geopolitics and security. And BBC Monitoring has a disinformation team, which works more widely with the rest of the BBC to investigate disinformation in particular. Now, welcome, Shayan. I'm so happy to have you with me as my guest for this episode, where we will discuss the topic of disinformation and its detection.
Hello, thank you. It's my pleasure being here.
Great, let's dive right in, actually. Just to get our listeners up to speed, could you provide some information about your professional background and your role with BBC Monitoring?
I'm a journalist with BBC Monitoring, investigating disinformation, conspiracy theories, cults, and their overlap with extremism. And I started working for the BBC in 2013. And back then, I joined the monitoring service as a journalist for their team covering Iran. So I'm Iranian, was born and raised in Iran. I've worked as a journalist in Iran. But then in my early 20s, I moved to the UK and got a master's degree in computers and IT, which my dad himself, a lifelong journalist, told me, you know, whatever you do with your career, never become a journalist. But I started working part-time as a journalist when I was 17. On the advice of my father, I tried to find a better career, a little bit more prestigious with more money. But then quickly I realized, you know, I enjoy journalism. I don't have any specific talents in any other fields, despite all the degrees and everything. So I got back to journalism when I moved to the UK, joined the BBC. For 5 or 6 years, I covered Iran and the Middle East. And then I moved to verification. So the BBC has a verification team called UGC, User Generated Content. So I worked there for about a year. And this was right at the time when the world was going a little bit insane. So there were terrorist attacks in France, in the UK. We had the US election campaign, so verification was actually quite significant back then, and then it sort of made me realize how important it is as a journalist in the modern age to be able to use information that is available on the internet to figure out what's true and what's not. And then immediately after the US election, obviously there was this, the world basically realized the problem of disinformation and conspiracy theories that we thought was not actually that much of an issue. It was just, you know, a small number of people who thought, you know, the earth is flat and the moon landing didn't happen. We sort of realized that that's not all that conspiracy theories are and how they can influence people. We realized that in the digital world, on online platforms, people can start believing in all sorts of bizarre things. And then based on those beliefs, go out in the real world and do something which could be harmful. So the BBC set up a team specifically focused on online disinformation and conspiracy theories. So from verification, I joined that team. It was like a natural progression. But it's very much a full-time job, and we sometimes even don't have enough time to look at everything and anything. And obviously, I don't need to tell you, with like the last 2 years with COVID, it's been absolutely mental. COVID has basically given rise to the biggest rise in online disinformation and conspiracy theories in my lifetime, I think.
Most certainly, and you definitely have a very impressive background. So generally speaking then, what does your day-to-day as a BBC monitoring journalist look like? Like, do you work exclusively with open source information, or do you also utilize other investigation methods?
In the morning, we have at like 10:30 in the morning, 10:30, we have an editorial meeting where all the journalists in the disinformation unit and our editors, we basically go through the stories that we've spotted either from the day in the UK and in Europe and in other parts of the world, or from the night before in North America or Latin America. And then basically decide which stories we should and we shouldn't cover. Obviously, I don't need to tell you, you know, that the world of disinformation and conspiracy theories, you know, include some really nasty, extreme elements, some of which are very fringe. So we always have to be careful about what we do cover and what we don't cover as a major news platform. We don't want to amplify everything and anything just because we're seeing it doesn't mean it's necessarily important. So the threshold for us always is it reaching the large enough audience to justify a platform like the BBC covering it? And is it actually doing some real world harm? In some cases, there are some, you know, conspiratorial or narratives that are not that big, but despite being small, they're still doing quite a lot of harm. So we always look at the size and whether there is some level of real world harm involved, in which case our editors then decide whether we should cover something. And when it comes to like measuring how big a narrative in like conspiratorial circles that we monitor, obviously that's completely down to open source techniques for us. You know, we use a variety of online tools. We sort of have experience in how we can gauge something that is going viral in either mainstream platforms or fringe platforms, but then from there going on major platforms to then decide whether, you know, is it reaching a few thousand people? Is it reaching, I don't know, tens of thousands of people, hundreds of thousands, or is it reaching millions?
Essentially, you use open source information, but then you would also use human intelligence if you were, for example, send an email or something like this, or you would
Absolutely, 100%. All the sort of tried and tested ways that journalists gather information we use, obviously. Every time we want to verify something, it's necessary, it's essential that we contact whoever or whatever we think is the source. Whether they do respond to us or not, that's another matter. But also, you know, we have to obviously give them the right of reply. So we have to contact them if you know, we think they deserve to have their say in our story. So, you know, from going online on some bizarre corners of the internet and getting information about, you know, what is this company? Who is this person? All the way to, okay, can we, you know, send this institution an email, or can we phone them? You know, all of those things we use depending on obviously the nature of the investigation.
So let's get right to it. How would you define disinformation, and how can open source intelligence facilitate the detection of disinformation?
Disinformation, I would say, I think you know, you read different definitions for it. I think the one that is accepted by most people who do this job is it's sharing any form of information with the deliberate intent to cause harm or to gain political or financial gain. And that is, in a sense, different from misinformation, in the sense that when it comes to what people categorize as misinformation, the intent is a little bit different. So you may not necessarily want to cause some kind of real world harm, or you're not necessarily gaining politically or financially from the piece of information that you're putting out. It's just you believe that it's true, or you just do it because, you know, for whatever reason you've got. Whereas disinformation is more like, you know, there's some kind of intent behind it. Obviously, we cover both of them, but there's usually more emphasis given to disinformation because it is assumed that there's some kind of malicious intent behind it. As for open source intelligence, I mean, it's really like bread and butter to this job. Obviously, open source intelligence and open source investigations are, you know, that's their own its own field in a sense, and it's an enormous world, and I know plenty of investigators online that do incredible things. I would say I've been using open source techniques for like 5 years now. You know, there are some people who do stuff out on the internet that you and I probably don't know what their real names are, but, you know, we see their work and we go, wow, you know, blows your mind. So I would say I'm not in any sense on their level, but I do use open source techniques. And I think all the journalists who do this job, all reporters, all researchers, all academics who do this job, inevitably have to use open source information. And the reason for that is we are not dealing with something that is easily accessible in the public domain. So if you're a journalist covering, say, a group of politicians, or you're covering a war, or you're covering some kind of international dispute, you know, you have some sources that are easily accessible to you from, you know, institutions, established institutions, politicians, governments, ministries, you know, all of those sources can basically help you about, you know, what's going on, can leak some information to you. The world of, you know, extremism and disinformation is completely different. We're talking about a group of people that are, first of all, fringe. And when I say fringe, I mean fringe in the sense of the entire population of the world. You know, obviously we know some disinformation campaigns and some disinformation narratives actually reach millions and millions of people. But the people who are actually invested in this and spend their time creating these pieces of information and then distributing it to the rest of the world, there's not that many. And most importantly, they're incredibly hostile to us, obviously, because they think we're part of the, you know, established institutions that are involved in some sort of conspiracy to do harm. Like, you know, when it comes to COVID, they think obviously journalists and academics and researchers, they're all basically part of this global conspiracy to basically infect the entire population of the world with this thing that happens to be a hoax, and also then vaccinate the entire population and, you know, somehow depopulate the earth. So we're basically, they're not going to cooperate with us, they're not going to help us in gathering information. So it's a little bit different to traditional journalism in that sense. And what we've got, obviously, in order to do an investigation is basically open source techniques. We know exactly where these people or these groups that share these pieces of information are. We follow them, we monitor their activities, but then when it comes to something that reaches millions of people, in order to figure out exactly who was behind a specific narrative, where it came from, is it just some individual? Is it just some groups of individuals? Is it is there potentially some state sponsored activity behind it? All of those things, in order to figure out those pieces of information, we need open source techniques in order to do the investigation. From, you know, it varies from, okay, we have to use some available information online to figure out, you know, what is this presumed company that's been set up in this part of the world and is doing this job? Is it actually a real company? Does it exist? Who's behind it? This particular, you know, group that's popped up on Facebook and has 100,000 people, who are the admins? Where are they based? What kind of people are behind that particular group? Where is the information from that group that has like 100,000 members? Where else is the information going? Are they actually really influential? Obviously, we're not, just to clarify, we're not in favor of censorship. Obviously, we're journalists and we rely on free speech to do our jobs. I come from a country where working as a journalist is a nightmare, exactly because there is no free speech. So I value free speech and I don't want people censored. But at the same time, sometimes there are some narratives that veer into the area of causing real world harm. So then we just sort of try to shine a light on it and say, this is happening.
Very interesting. Thank you for that elaboration. So since you mentioned COVID-19 and the conspiracy theory surrounding that topic, let's discuss some of these ever-evolving disinformation campaigns about COVID-19 and the vaccination mandates. So as I think as we're all aware by now, anti-vaccine movements have hardened across Europe in the recent months and are frequently accompanied by disinformation or fake news campaigns, right? So would you agree with a rather popular sentiment that COVID-19 conspiracy theorists can be categorized in political groups such as right, left, or center? And if so, what common traits and or ideas do they share?
Yeah, that is actually a really good but difficult question to answer, because having done this job for more 4 or 5 years now, I would tell you that seeing the world of conspiracy theories and extremism through the traditional established framework of left, right, center, you know, sideways, up or down, that doesn't necessarily work for the world of conspiracy theories, because first and foremost, these people who are committed to doing this and sharing this information and actually going out in the world and doing something about it, including, as you mentioned, all of these violent protests that we've seen across Europe and in other parts of the world. First and foremost, they are anti-establishment. So it doesn't matter whether there's a right-wing government or there's a left-wing government or there's a centrist government, they hate every established institution. And they think they all share some degree of responsibility for what has now become basically a grand conspiracy in their minds. But basically it just started from, okay, COVID is a hoax. And then gradually it went into the area of, okay, COVID is real, but these lockdowns are basically, well, obviously most of us are not in lockdowns anymore, thankfully. But back, you know, going back 2 years ago, obviously most of the world was in lockdown. Not now, but like a month from now, around about March, April 2020, the world was basically shut down. So initially there was opposition to lockdown. And again, that was a problem because for us to cover, because there are some legitimate reasons to be against lockdowns. Like, you know, you can say, you know, a government can use other tools to stop the spread of infections. Lockdowns cause mental health issues. That's all fine. There was a group of people who were so committed to being against lockdown in the sense that they thought lockdown and COVID as a whole were basically some kind of a plot. And then we started seeing names coming in from George Soros to Bill Gates to, you know, the usual favorites of conspiracy theorists, the Rockefellers, the Rothschilds, Freemasons, you know, you just put all of that in. World Economic Forum apparently was kind of involved in it. And all the major governments, from the Chinese government to the American government, to the British government, to the German government, you know, you name it. They were also all part of this mass conspiracy. And then, as you say, when the vaccinations began, well, that was like, it went into overdrive. But what happened was, despite the fact that the anti-vax movement globally, relatively, has always been a fringe movement, the internet, particularly major platforms, gave the anti-vax movement the opportunity to spread completely false narratives to millions and probably billions of people around the world. And that obviously we know for a fact caused some vaccine hesitancy in some parts of the world. Thankfully, you know, where I am, it despite the fact that the British anti-vax movement is incredibly prolific online and very loud, and also has been one of the most active offline as well. So basically on a weekly basis, we've had anti-vax protests here. But it hasn't really penetrated the minds of the population at large here in the UK, for instance. We have a really, really high vaccination uptake rate. Nearly 90% of our population aged 12 or over has had one dose of the vaccine. Nearly 80% is fully vaccinated. I think it's pretty much the same in Austria, if I'm not mistaken. So in some countries, it has had an impact. In some other countries, it hasn't. And people basically, despite the fact that the narratives go online and reach a huge percentage of people, in some cases, people have just completely ignored them. But it still has been a problem because it's not just about the online narratives. We've also seen all sorts of violent protests across the world. In some cases, we've seen people trying, you know, going into vaccination centers, trying to shut down vaccination centers, confronting staff, confronting police. We've seen people go into hospitals. We also had some links to terrorism. In Germany, we know like there was a family that they were so opposed to vaccinations and vaccine mandates that they basically became convinced the state was coming for them and they were going to lose their job. So a family of five, the father killed himself, his wife, and the three children. So it's not just the people who go, okay, this is just a bunch of, you know, bizarre people saying stupid things online. That's not the case.
You are listening to the Intelligence Brief podcast, OSINT and its application. On the edge of the intelligence topic, this show features conversations with expert guests discussing the application of innovative OSINT strategies in the security and defense sector.
So the COVID pandemic, basically, as I said earlier, in my lifetime, I've never seen anything like it in terms of the spread of conspiracies and online disinformation and misinformation. It's been mental. The next question, obviously, would be, you know, where it's going to go from here, given, thankfully, we are slowly but surely coming out of this pandemic thanks to vaccinations.
So regarding, just because you mentioned Germany, let's take that as an example. In Germany, anti-vax or anti-restriction movements, let's call them that, have recently taken the form of so-called Monday evening freedom walks. And in the German federal state of Saxony, I think, which has one of the lowest vaccination rates in Germany, these Monday evening freedom walks appear to be backed up by a right-wing extremist group called the Free Saxons. I think they were categorized as extremists last year. And they appear to be using these protests as a way to spread their ideology, right? And to reach out to more people. So would you describe the situation in the UK as similar in terms of like the overlap of extremism and the anti-vax movement or not, or as in, are extremist groups using the pandemic and the government imposed restrictions as an opportunity to reach out to more people?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, it's good that you mentioned Germany, because Germany is actually a really fascinating case. Germany has been integral to the global COVID conspiracy movement. And that's something that actually caught us by surprise. We didn't expect it. Obviously, we know some countries that are very influential when it comes to the world of, you know, conspiracies. America, us, unfortunately, in the UK, Brazil, India. But we didn't expect Germany actually to be there. But from the very beginning, Germany was one of the countries that was very essential to basically giving these online voices, which were really fragmented, some kind of purpose, first of all, and then organizing mass protests globally, what they wanted to be mass protests.
So, for example, according to Statista, in 2020, 80% of Germans asked friends or relatives for information, and 70% searched the internet for information. And only 50% watched reports on television. Now, you can obviously see how the first two ways of gathering information, namely to ask friends and family or to search the vast space of the internet, may be an issue in terms of the spread of disinformation.
We noticed a movement on Facebook and Telegram, and it called itself Worldwide Protests. Initially, it was Worldwide Protests Against Lockdowns, and then it became Worldwide Protests Against COVID Vaccinations. And it was basically organizing rallies all around the world. So from towns and cities in the UK to America, to Germany, to the Netherlands, to France, to Belgium, you know, to Hungary, all the way to say, you know, even in the Middle East, in Turkey, in even South Korea, Japan. It was organizing rallies and basically putting out these dates, and then the date would come, and then we would see in many of those locations, some people would turn up. Now, obviously there were varying degrees of people that turned up in parts of America, in the UK, in Germany, in France, and there would be relatively big numbers, Brazil. But what was interesting was something that had come out of nowhere and was just putting out dates saying, oh, gather here, protest against lockdown or vaccinations or whatever, was being seen and people were turning up. And then it turned out that the people behind that group was just like a group, I think group of a few individuals in the German town of Kassel. It was interesting because I'm pretty sure many of the people who were turning out to these protests around the world had no idea what this group was and who was behind it. And they was, you know, basically just a group of individuals in Kassel, Germany. What mattered to them was like somebody was doing something to bring these voices together. And they were turning out in, as I say, varying degrees, but in some cases, big numbers. And then Germany was also fascinating because back in the summer of 2020, Germany was one of the, so I spend quite a lot of my time also specifically looking into the QAnon conspiracy, which quite a lot of people think is now over, but it isn't. But Germany was also one of the countries, so QAnon obviously from October 2017, when it began on 4chan, all the way to, I would say, just before the pandemic, it saw enormous growth, we know that, but it was mostly confined to America because the entire narrative, the entire story was focused on US politics, on President Trump, and the Democrats. So it had not that much, basically, other people, other conspiracies around the world were interested in it, but there wasn't much in it for them to turn into actual QAnon followers or activists. It was COVID, like when COVID hit and the world shut down in March, April 2020. Suddenly, all of these QAnon circles on Facebook, on Twitter, on Instagram, on TikTok, on Telegram that we've been monitoring and was mostly populated by actual real Americans, suddenly they start getting loads and loads of new followers from around the world, particularly in Europe, and particularly from countries like the UK, Germany, France, the Netherlands. And Germany was actually one of the first non-US countries that started organizing specific rallies in support of QAnon. And then it came to the UK, went to France, went to the Netherlands. So Germany has been a really fascinating example of a country that mostly is, you know, a very good democratic free nation with a fantastic, a very, very well-respected government, very stable. But we have seen how online disinformation and misinformation have caused some kind of instability to a small extent, because Germany has, if you look at the vaccination rates in Germany, it has a very high rate of vaccine uptake. So the vast majority of Germans obviously completely reject this stuff, but still a small group of radicalized people can do some extreme things that causes quite a lot of issues. So quite a lot of people were genuinely against some of the COVID restrictions or lockdown because, you know, they were not necessarily conspiracy theorists. They were just, you know, I'm suffering, my business is hurting, you know, I can't put food on the table, or I basically have, you know, issues in terms of my mental health. I want to see my family members. I want to see my loved ones. I'm done with it. You know, whatever it may be. So they were basically turning up in these anti-lockdown rallies, which in some cases, as I said, basically attracted tens of thousands of people in London, for instance. But as restrictions have gone, it's become basically a smaller core of genuine conspiracists who are actually, because all of the things that they've been campaigning for like 2 years, and they feel like they're completely marginalized and no one's listening to them and mainstream media is ignoring them. And in their minds, obviously complete nonsense, but in their minds, people are being killed by these vaccines and children are dropping dead everywhere. They've become much more radicalized. And we are now seeing, I would say, we are in the most extreme phase of COVID conspiracies in the UK, particularly in the last 2 months, which is kind of, again, ironic because we are living under no restrictions now. But those core extreme conspiracy theorists are now basically turning up outside vaccination centers, openly confronting police officers, people who are doing vaccinations, and members of the public who are just sort of queuing up to get vaccinated. They are confronting our politicians. They've been campaigning outside schools and they've been harassing children, their parents. They've been going to mass events and causing disturbance. So I would say, despite the fact that we have fewer actual real world activists in UK conspiracy circles now compared to any time in the last 2 years, they are actually much more radicalized and they're prepared to go much further than many other people who initially joined the movement are.
Yeah, so what our audience is interested in is obviously, where do we go from here?
So where it goes from here, I honestly don't know. It is in a sense a good sign, I would say. It is a good sign that first of all, you know, countries like Germany or the UK, where we know these narratives have reached millions of people, still have really high vaccination rates. So it means many people have seen these conspiracies online and they've gone, nah, it's not for me. It's rubbish. You know, I'm gonna go get vaccinated. But at the same time, it means there are people who are so invested in these COVID conspiracies that despite the fact that in some parts of the world, there are no restrictions and we're definitely slowly going back to normal life, they're not going to give up. And what will happen to those people, to those core groups of conspiracies, some of whom were completely unfamiliar with the world of conspiracy theories and disinformation before COVID. They've just been introduced to it in the last 2 years. But that's another issue when you spend so much of your time, so much of your life creating content about a specific topic, investing emotionally into it. Even when all the evidence in the real world goes against your beliefs, you're not gonna just stop. You're gonna double down, you're gonna triple down. So I think they'll probably continue, but it's also, we have to say, it's a good thing that they're becoming smaller and smaller.
Yeah, definitely. Actually, what I have come across more recently is a very absurd disinformation campaign where internet users who seem to be committed to the anti-vax movement shared in, I think it was in a Facebook group, that COVID vaccines can cause HIV. So how popular is this very obviously false idea online? Have you heard of it? And how do you monitor the spread of such an idea as part of your work?
Yeah, this is actually one of the newest narratives, completely baseless, nonsensical narratives that have spread online. I first saw it back in November, and it was in the form of VAIDS, so VAIDS. And I saw it on Facebook, on Twitter, on TikTok. And basically it's vaccine immunodeficiency syndrome. So obviously AIDS is an illness that we all know caused by the virus HIV. Back in November, we started seeing these messages online that COVID vaccines cause AIDS, and they start calling it VAIDS. And some sort of famous anti-vaxxers that you know, I'm sure both you and I know, And some others who most recently actually were involved in a rally in Washington, D.C. against vaccine mandates. And one of them was actually severely criticized for comparing COVID restrictions to the Holocaust. Some of these people who have hundreds of thousands of followers online, they basically amplified it. And once those types of people get involved, we know it's gonna reach an enormous audience. So we have seen quickly, like in the UK now, all of these anti-vaxxers and anti-vaccine activists and protesters who go outside vaccination centers or go outside schools or go outside government buildings, they constantly mention that, why aren't you doing anything about, you know, people are getting AIDS because of these vaccines. It's something that came out of basically just some people came up with this narrative, started sharing it, making videos about it, and then slowly reached more people online. And then once the anti-vax, you know, major anti-vax influencers got involved and amplified it. And in some parts of the COVID conspiracy movement, it's now completely accepted as fact. Like, you know, there's no debate about it now. Like, you know, even if he put out something saying, you know, talk to some immunologist or some scientist or some doctor who's saying, you know, this is complete nonsense, it has absolutely no basis in reality, it's not going to change their minds, it's not going to change their views. They're now completely convinced that COVID vaccines are causing AIDS. What can you do about it? Well, all we can do, as I say, is to do our work and say, you know, the view of actual experts is this is nonsense. Whether that's going to change those people's minds, who knows? Probably not.
Most likely not those people's minds, but maybe other people's minds.
Hopefully. That's the hope, right?
Yeah. So on Twitter, on your Twitter account, you mentioned, and I quote, that COVID has dominated the conspiracy world for 2 years, bringing into the fold a legion of new followers. And then you asked your Twitter followers to share their ideas about the potential next battleground conspiracy theorists could choose after the pandemic has come to an end. Now, obviously, I find that idea you had there quite fascinating. Now, I'm curious to know as to whether, firstly, did they come up with any interesting ideas? And secondly, whether you yourself have been able to identify any trends that could shape the online conspiracy landscape in the future?
You know, in our work, our work has been completely dominated by COVID for 2 years. And there's all the evidence suggests that, at least I would say in the Western world, we're coming out of COVID. Like, most of our populations are now vaccinated. Omicron is proving to be a mild variant. The rates of hospitalizations and deaths pretty much all around the Western world are falling. It's not by any means over in some other parts of the world, in some you know, third world nations, unfortunately, still. So it was a genuine question, like, all of these people who have invested so much in COVID for 2 years, where are they going to go from here? Because they're not going to, you know, they're not going to suddenly stop. They're not going to go, okay, that's done for us. As I said, one of the problems of conspiracy theories is, and one of the reasons it's, most experts say it's really vital that you stop people from getting into that world first and foremost. Once you're deep into the rabbit hole of, you know, different conspiracies, it's so difficult to come out of it. People do it, and I know in my real life people who've done it, I've spoken to people who've done it, but all of them say it's actually really hard work. And also, when you've invested so much of your time, so much effort into sharing a particular narrative, it's really hard to tell yourself, I was wrong.
You are listening to the Intelligence Brief podcast, OSINT and its application. For more intelligence topics, join in the next HENSOLDT Analytics Intelligence webinar. In a live session, we bring together experts and practitioners to discuss the latest intelligence topics and deconstruct real-life scenarios through the prism of OSINT. The next intelligence webinar takes place on March 16th, 2022. Register on our website to save your seat.
So where are they going to go from here? That was my genuine question. And quite a lot of people responded. And it seemed to me that most people were sort of agreeing on climate change. And obviously climate change is basically a major issue for all of us. And as we get closer and closer to, you know, what scientists say, you know, obviously as the temperature, the global temperatures continue to rise, it's going to become more of an issue. Most of the world, most people are now sort of agree on the fact that global temperatures are rising. It's now moving towards, from climate denial, it's moving towards what you do about it. And that's probably, again, that's like a world of completely valid debates. You know, what should governments do? How far should they go? How costly are all these measures to tackle climate change are going to be? You know, that's all valid, and that's not for us to get involved in. We are particularly looking at conspiracy theories. We are looking at false narratives. And there is some evidence that climate change is going to, as we move forward in the years ahead, is going to rise as a major issue for the world of conspiracy theories. Another one I would say, which completely surprised us, but is becoming concerningly more predominant in the sort of global world of conspiracies, is sovereign citizen theories. It's a movement that came out of America in the 1960s and 70s. In the sort of 1990s, early 2000s, it also came to Europe and some other parts of the world, but it's always been kind of fringe. It's like a group of anti-government people thinking, you know, they can pick and choose which national laws or international laws they abide by. And they personally have to give consent to everything and anything. And it's complete nonsense, but it was always very fringe. However, in the last year or so, out of the movement that's been sort of obsessed about COVID conspiracies, these sovereign citizen theories have suddenly become really popular in parts of Europe, in parts of Latin America, in countries where we'd never seen sovereign citizen theories spread. Now, that's really... That's a point of concern, because it is actually a real extremist movement. So it's not just about, I'm not going to follow this law or that law. It's also about, I'm going to actively fight and confront authorities and the government. Now, in America, obviously, that poses all sorts of other problems, because, you know, Americans have the right to bear arms. In countries like ours, you know, where most of the population is not actually armed, it poses a completely different set of issues. Like we've seen in the UK, these people are sort of walking into vaccination centres and attempting in their minds to arrest police officers, arrest members of the armed forces who are administering vaccines. They genuinely think they've got the right to do that. They're sort of attempting to put under arrest healthcare workers. They're taking patients out of hospital. They think they've got the right to go inside a hospital. And it is a huge problem, as I say, because first of all, it's really extreme. And second, it convinces believers and followers that they have all sorts of rights to do things that most normal people realize, you know, that they can't do. So that's another thing that really concerns me. And we've had some groups that, particularly in the UK, and also this group in Germany, by the way, that has become a little bit bigger, who just go and get basically training in terms of, you know, they want to get martial arts training, boxing training. And then they're completely convinced that they have all sorts of rights under what they refer to as common law, to basically walk into a vaccination center, or walk into a school and arrest people and just shut down a vaccination center. So that's another problem, I would say. Climate change and what particularly concerns me is sovereign citizen narratives.
Yeah, I am actually familiar with that movement specifically because I have been monitoring it before in Germany as it's been gaining traction. It's been around for quite some time, but as you said, it is definitely gaining followership at the moment and in recent months. So yeah, let's see what's yet to come. We will most certainly monitor these post-COVID changes in the conspiracy landscape. I think both you and I, and unfortunately, we've already reached my final question for you. So in the future, in your opinion, what methodologies and or technologies would be required to facilitate the detection of disinformation or potentially even the detection of bot accounts or bot farms, so to speak?
When it comes to verification tools, I mean, we do have video verification tools. Obviously, it doesn't work with every video. You know, some videos are really difficult to verify. And I've been involved in investigations that involved verifying a video that took a month. But there are also others that are relatively easy. And, you know, those types of tools help us. So as long as they maintain them, as long as, you know, they try to update them regularly, that's really nice. Another thing I would say where it's a bit of a gray area is the use of GANs. So all of these images of people that don't actually exist, you know, they're completely, they're created by artificial intelligence and they look completely convincing, particularly when you see them in a Facebook profile or in a Twitter profile, because you're not seeing the image in high resolution, you're just coming across it. Sometimes if you see them in high resolution, you figure out, okay, there's something wrong here. There's something wrong with the background, there's something wrong with the eyebrow, whatever. So that's a particular issue. And we've seen actual influence operations use those GAN-generated images to pose as real people. So somebody comes, you know, there's an influence operation and they have to create completely fake, inauthentic accounts. How do you sort of try to pose as a real person, basically sharing this piece of information? You create some GAN images. If you could get some tool, I mean, it's possible to do analysis with it. You know, there are, as I say, there are some telltale signs, but we haven't got something easily available or accessible to most people for which they can sort of check, okay, is this actually a GAN image or not? That's a problem. That's an area that is a problem. Another one is the rise of these influence operations that are done by PR agencies, companies, so-called social analytics companies that basically start an influence operation and then they hire actual people. So say you're a government and you want to run an influence operation in an African country, but you want to make sure that your campaign is not easily it's not easily spottable. So, and we know, like, you know, if you've got Facebook groups or if you've got Facebook pages, Facebook actually has a box that pops up that says, you know, where the admins of this particular page are based. So if you're running an operation from a third country, it you know, it's easily available to researchers and journalists to see, okay, why is this particular person in Albania so interested in running a Facebook page of 20,000 people about, say, Mozambique, any country you can think of. But in order to sidestep that, they hire actual people in, say, Mozambique to run those pages for them. But all the information and all the content is coming from the people who are behind the operation, say in Albania or in UK or in France or in Germany or whatever. And then it becomes really difficult to actually investigate. And because you're seeing a page in Mozambique, based in Mozambique, and you go, okay, these are actually genuine people in Mozambique who are interested in their politics or in COVID or whatever, and they're sharing this information. So it's completely legitimate, whereas it isn't. There's really no way actually to spot those things. Deepfakes get mentioned. I don't want to talk too much about deepfakes because I don't think they're that big of an issue yet. okay, you can make really good deepfakes if you're invested in making one, but it's actually really costly and it takes quite a long time. So unless and until it's possible for me as a random individual to use my smartphone or use my laptop or use my gadget or use my desktop PC, whatever it is, and easily in 10 minutes, 15 minutes, create a really convincing deep fake. Until we're at that stage, I wouldn't say it's a major problem. Where we get to in 5 years or 10 years, you know, that's another matter. As I say, as long as your random individual can easily create a convincing deep fake, for me, we're not in sort of really dangerous territory yet. When it comes to sort of fringe platforms, I know like some really creative investigators have come up with their own tools and, you know, have written their own programs to be able to at least scrap some data from this tool or that tool, or get some information or do some basic analysis. But those platforms are still a major black hole to us. And all we have to do is basically manual, which takes quite a lot of time. So yeah, I mean, those are the major issues. But on the other hand, I talked about all the negatives, have to talk about some positives. We're constantly seeing, you know, more open source information being made available to us. You know, we now have information about global shipping, we have information about airlines, all the flights that happen around the world, we can actually monitor them. We can go to some specific detail about, you know, what ship, what vessel in the world is where and doing what, where they came from, where they're going, who owns them, who's paying for them. When it comes to satellite images, we're getting to some really good places now. Okay, still a costly place. Still, you have to pay quite a lot of money to some of these companies that provide high resolution satellite images of some areas of the world that is not covered that well by, say, Google Earth. You still have to pay quite a lot of money, but it's available. And the gap between when an incident happens, like last year when there was these explosions in the one Iranian nuclear facility in Natanz, it was about 48 hours until we got some high-res images from a couple of these companies of what had actually the aftermath of the explosion in there that were really helpful, because we could then analyze and go, okay, it's happened in this corner. What type of explosion is it? Is it, can we see some debris? What type of debris is it? And then we can contact actual experts and say, okay, what could it be? What do you think has caused this explosion based on these images? So that's really helpful. And we're getting better and better in that. We're still not at a point when, you know, an incident happens and then 10 minutes later, we've got higher satellite images. We're not there yet, but we're getting close. We're getting really close. You know, 24 hours, 48 hours, that's great. Again, in Afghanistan, when we were, you know, when we had the evacuations in Afghanistan and we had the terrorist attack there, again, these satellite images were really helpful about getting a sense of what's going on there, because we weren't getting that much information, obviously, from the Taliban. And we were just relying on some handmade videos by somebody holding a smartphone in the area or the high-res satellite images that were coming in. So I think technology is obviously always getting better and trying to keep up with all the other things that bad actors are using, but it is forever a cat and mouse game. And we'll continue doing what we do, hopefully, and we'll find new ways of getting the information that we want. But you know, the same information is also available to bad actors, so they're gonna know what new tools, what new techniques are out there, and they're gonna try and sidestep them all the time.
Yeah, fair enough. Agreed. And I reckon technology is catching up. And yes, it is a cat and mouse game. But since you mentioned AI, for example, in terms of tools for fake news detection, There's, for example, AI-supported hate speech detection developed, or fake news detection, AI-supported fake news detection, and these will also become increasingly popular tools, that researchers and academics and journalists and security contractors can use, and security personnel. So
I would just add, when it comes to AI, some degree of human involvement is still necessary. Rely on AI to and automated tools to give you all the information that you want. Some human involvement is still necessary, some human expertise to go through, what these automated tools can spot and then verify is still required. But as long as that help is available, that also is brilliant, because it basically cuts down the amount of manual work that somebody like you needs to do.
Yeah. And I mean, as an analyst, I absolutely and wholeheartedly agree with that sentiment. Obviously, I think that the combination of, AI and a human touch or analysis is absolutely mandatory to reach a thorough analysis in the end, and that creates some actionable intelligence. We have unfortunately reached the end of this episode, and may I just say what an interesting episode it was. Thank you so much, Shayan, for taking the time, and thank you for providing such insightful content for our audience and for myself as well.
Thank you.
And to all of our listeners, thanks for tuning in. And as per usual, if you happen to have any questions, feel free to contact us directly. So have a great day, and we'll see you next time.
Follow us on your usual podcast platform and tune in for our next episode of the Intelligence Brief Podcast.